Winston Churchill once told Stalin, "The Mediterranean is the soft underbelly of the crocodile." Churchill and the British chiefs of staff were sure that attacking German-occupied Europe through Italy would help shorten the war.
I can see him now at his map in his persuasive way with his pointer pointing out the soft belly of the Mediterranean. And after we got in there, I often thought of what a tough old gut it was instead of the soft belly that he had led us to believe.
That was General Mark Clark, who led the American Fifth Army in the invasion of Italy during World War II. 60-plus years after it began, for most people, World War II is remembered mostly through ubiquitous cable channel documentaries, old films airing on late-night television, or perhaps more recent Hollywood features like Schindler's List, Saving Private Ryan, and U-571. For me, World War II has been experienced through the eyes of family members who fought on both sides of the war. My mother, Maria Sartorio, was raised in Sicily before and during World War II.
I was born January 25th, 1936, in San Piero Patti, in Provincia Messina in Sicily.
Meanwhile, on the other side of the world, a close friend, Frank Newts, was growing up.
I was born on January 30th, 1919, in Carbondale, Pennsylvania.
During the NATO air war against Serbia, along with millions of other people around the world, I watched the long columns of the Kosovar refugees make the perilous journey to ill-equipped relief camps. The footage brought back especially strong memories for my mother. For her, as with many survivors of war, the psychological effects can last a lifetime.
It wasn't a pretty sight. Sometimes I have nightmares of what went on. I remember one particular time your father took us to Wildwood, New Jersey. We were at the beach. My first experience, good thing I had a babysitter to watch you guys, and all at once, there was a formation of the airplanes coming. Do you think I was thinking of you guys? I just started running to the house, and I kept screaming. I was running up the street, screeching, "They're coming, they're coming." And the landlord says, "Maria, what's the matter?" I said, the Germans are coming. They're going to kill us." And she literally shook me. She says, "What Germans?" I said, "There's planes at the sea, you know, at the beach. They're going to kill us." And she said, "Well, where are your kids?" That stopped me from screeching. I forgot the kids at the beach. And she says, "No, it's the Coast Guards maneuvering over the beach. They're not enemies. They are Coast Guard. They're one of us." I have nightmares of their airplanes going by to this day.
While Italy suffered under the German presence, America was preparing for the inevitable invasion. Frank Newts, then a young man in his early 20s, served as a stenographer under General Walker as part of the U.S. Fifth Army that would invade Italy at Salerno.
I was drafted into the Army, entered active service on May 5th, 1942. I was assigned to the 143rd Infantry Regiment. A vacancy occurred in the Adjutant General's office for a stenographer. I applied for the position and got it. I was transferred to the commanding general, Major General Fred L. Walker. He was later assigned to the infantry school at Fort Benning, Georgia, as commandant. I joined him at Fort Benning around September of 1944.
As a young man from Carbondale, Pennsylvania, the war presented Frank Newts with the opportunity to serve his country and see the world. An entirely different set of expectations and experiences than for my mother.
I often think of things that occurred to me in Italy that I experienced, the places I've seen. Being in the position I was in, I was able to get into the Vatican in places where the rank and file couldn't get. And I enjoyed all that, and I enjoyed the places I've seen, which I probably would never have seen had it not been for the war.
In the course of his duties, the young GI had a rare opportunity for an audience with Pope Pius XII. The wartime pontiff's actions during the war have been the subject of ongoing debate. Many suggest that he could have done more to speak out against Nazi war crimes.
He's being criticized for not doing enough, but they don't realize that he did help something like 300,000 on the QT. His hands were tied. He could, if he took an open stance on that, You know what would happen? They would line up these civilians and shoot them down like cattle. I thought, in my own mind, and from what I know and read, I thought he handled it well. He was able to free a lot of those civilians.
There had been support among the civilian population for the fascist regimes. Frank Newts and my mother tried to explain their appeal.
Mussolini was admired a lot in Italy before the war. He did a lot for the Italians. But once he became part of the Axis Pact with Hitler, he lost all good that he did. They had no use for him. They considered him a puppet of Hitler, and that was it. It's too bad he spoiled everything he ever did for them.
Well, there's a good side of Mussolini, and there's a bad side of Mussolini. We were very poor, and he did a lot of good, till the war broke out, and I don't know where he went crazy himself.
During the war, members of my extended family served in the American, Italian, and German armies. My Italian grandfather discovered he had a German half-brother by accident when he received someone else's mail while both were interned at an American POW camp.
So he went back. This was while he was in prison. And the guy looked it up. He says that we have two sartorios here. So he called the other guy. My father says, my name is Mario Sebastiano Sartorio. And he says, my name is Sebastiano Sartorio. So my father says, he says, well, you're German. And he says, yeah, you're an Italian. He asked him, who was your father? And he said, we are brothers. And this is how my father found out that there were 12 brothers.
While researching my family history, I discovered my grandfather, despite his experience in the war, or perhaps because of it, was a lifelong admirer of Adolf Hitler.
Even here in America, he kept saying the greatest speaker was Hitler. How he shook the world when he made that big speech in the square or in the balcony. He would get it right in the middle of the living room floor here in America, and he put his hand and he started shouting, going through the motions of how Hitler made that kind of a speech. He was terrifying me. I said, my God, he's a maniac. What's happening? I would run. I would go upstairs and just stay in my bedroom. I said, my God, he's going crazy.
Despite the Hollywood movies that seem to portray all Sicilians as peasants, my mother's family, in fact, was well off. They owned two large homes and three farms. However, German foraging and theft robbed them and other Sicilians of their food. As a result, 1943 to 1945 were years of starvation.
The Germans took everything that we had. And I remember one particular time, we were 14 families and we had two loaves of bread, and the bread was stale. You know what my mother did? She got a big bowl of water. We had to boil the water. That's why the water was hot. And she got the two loaves. She would cut into slice and then the slice into strips and pass out to everybody. And this bowl was full of warm water. And we duck our bread in the hot water and put it in our mouth. And that's the only way we could swallow the bread.
Anything about what the Germans did that still stands out in your mind?
Well, I think that they were cowards. You know, we never looked in the face the Germans because we were scared. We never knew what they looked like. All except they were mean, you know, and we were afraid to them.
Sicily, as agreed at Casablanca, was the next item on the agenda. Only 2 months after the German collapse in Tunisia, the British and Americans began landing troops on Sicilian beaches.
The Germans retreated from Sicily in such a hurry that they left behind mines and munitions that fell into innocent, unsuspecting hands.
When the Germans left, we went to where the Germans were camping and left all this equipment, dark bread laying around, ammunition. And these we didn't know as kids what the things were, but a lot of kids got blown up. Even if we walk around that camp, there were mines in the ground. Us kids didn't know, and I was always the last one in line. I wanted to go. I wanted to see the excitement, but I was scared, and a lot of my friends just. Psh.
As the U.S. Army occupied Italy, Italian-American GIs were often called upon to help the local population, even when loyalties were still divided.
We were occupying the mayor of the town's villa there in San Prisco. This is right outside of Naples. His wife was a very staunch Catholic. He was a Hitler sympathizer. He was a Nazi, true and through. So she wanted to have a mission at the church there. So two guys came to me and asked if I couldn't get a transportation to take them to this place up in Nola, up in the mountain, this monastery, and bring a missionary down, which I did. She was so thrilled and pleased, they couldn't do enough for me.
If the Nazi presence brought fear and intimidation, then the arrival of the Allies certainly generated relief and gratitude.
The Americans, they were our friends, we were our angels.
They greeted us with open arms, and they were very good to the GIs. They couldn't do enough for us. They were relieved to be out from under the German presence there. And they were so thrilled at their newfound freedom that they couldn't do enough for us.
World War II has an epic, almost mythical quality about it that seems to grow as years go by, and the participants begin to pass away. As a reporter, someone who uses words for a living, I am reminded that the destruction of World War II began not with a shot, but with a word.
Als unsere Partei gerade 7 Mann hoch war, brach sie schon 2 Grundsätze aus. Erstens, sie wollte eine wahrhaftige Weltanschauungspartei sein. Und zweitens, sie wollte daher kompromisslos die einzige Macht und alleinige Macht in Deutschland.